Europe's on a pathway to climate neutrality by 2050. And as sectors are more and more electrifying, the expansion of renewable energy generation is urgently needed. The EU plans a significant share of this expansion at sea. In addition to increasing the installed offshore wind capacity by a factor of 25, other forms of renewable offshore energy, such as solar, wave, and tidal, will also be expanded. Electricity generation with offshore renewable technologies has many advantages. Large areas and various energy sources are available at sea, and higher and more constant wind speeds mean that an offshore wind farm generates energy more regularly and reliably than a farm on land. While contributing to our climate goals, renewable energy generation, as well as other economic sectors, such as shipping and fishing, are putting pressure on the marine ecosystems, whose ecological state is already degraded. Seas not only serve as a habitat for countless animals and plants, but also as the biggest natural CO2 sink. The EU has therefore allocated an important place in its biodiversity strategy to the protection and restoration of marine areas. This means that the use of marine space must be considered holistically, and with both biodiversity and users of the sea in mind. Of course, this impacts the planning and infrastructure, such as wind parks and their grid connections. A wind turbine generates electrical energy, which is transported to the onshore grid via an offshore grid connection system. To increase efficiency and avoid additional strains on the ecosystem by many individual offshore cables, the energy is first collected in an offshore substation, and then ideally bundled in a very powerful offshore cable. Alongside the construction of this grid connection, the onshore grid must also be strengthened to transport the electricity generated offshore to consumption centres on land.
As a TSO, transmission system operator, we see the need for large volumes of renewable energy feed-in in our system for the future. And offshore offers this opportunity, actually. There we have space to connect large volumes of offshore wind in a timely manner, and that's what we need as a society.
But how do we protect biodiversity at sea?
First of all, you make sure that you avoid the most ecologically valuable areas. So for example, for the underwater world, in a wind farm, you do not have any fishing generally. So that means that the seabed is left alone. And that means that it can grow, it can be restored. You can, for example, reintroduce oysters. And oysters are good because they filter the water, but they also create reefs. And from the reefs, you start to create ecosystems. You have little crabs, you have little fish, you have all sorts of things. And then, of course, other animals go to that area, and that can really create nice ecosystems.
Yeah, I think there are some legally designated areas that have to be protected, and that's a part the government can take a part in. And at the same time, also, space is limited. So if we have to use more space for offshore wind areas, do this in a sensitive way. Apply the best available technologies, but also monitor long-term effects. And I think there's still a knowledge gap we should fill here.
One of the biggest problems that we have at the moment is the noise that is produced. To mitigate that noise, a very common practice is to use bubble curtains. Those bubble curtains absorb the noise and therefore produce less disturbance to the animals around them. Another way is, for example, to use sleeves around the turbine or to use blue piling that does not produce noise at all.
So for the cable systems in our offshore grid connections, we use our strategy of bury and forget. And that means we only disturb the environment once. And for this operation, obviously, we prepare a good installation method, considering the turbidity we cause, moving the soil around, but also considering the emissions that come from the installation vessels. And by taking these perspectives into account, we come to a safe installation from technical perspective, but also from environmental perspective.
Even with careful siting, rotor blades pose a potential danger to birds. But further collisions can be reduced through selective temporary shutdown of the turbines. Underwater, there is also noise pollution from turbines, which can be decreased through the development of floating turbines. Meanwhile, positive impacts can be achieved by using the area of the wind park to restore the marine ecosystem. For example, by planting seagrass or the installation of artificial reefs. Currently, wind turbines must be replaced or dismantled after about 25 years. To maximize resource efficiency and move towards a circular economy, an eco-design approach and further research, especially on the recycling of rotor blades, are required. But it is clearly important to ensure that newly created ecosystems are not destroyed again during dismantling. Therefore, it makes sense to retain some underwater structures, such as foundations and cables. For the future of our energy system planning, this means that by planning and implementing the right approaches early, impacts on the environment can be minimized and positive effects on the ecosystem can be achieved. Comprehensive marine spatial planning can also resolve conflicts of interest by promoting the co-use of areas. For example, for energy generation and sustainable fishing, and cross-border cooperation and sharing of generation plants, grid connections and interconnectors allow us to use our resources efficiently.
We need increased collaborations between stakeholders across sectors, but also across borders, in order to tackle together the biodiversity and climate crisis. We need to jointly design solutions that are good for energy and nature, and we need to apply them at scale. The Renewables Grid Initiative works on this as founder and convener of the Offshore Coalition for Energy and Nature, also called OCEAN. Within OCEAN, NGOs, wind industry, and electricity grid operators work together in order to enable the accelerated expansion of offshore wind and grid, and the alignment of these with conservation and restoration objectives. In order to meet this challenge, we need to join forces and collaborate even more.